Hello and welcome to In the Studio from the BBC World Service. This is the podcast which explores creativity by speaking to some of the leading makers and innovators working today. I'm Carl Boss, and in this episode, we're going to be meeting an artist who's had incredible levels of success and built up an immense online following. The Norwegian DJ and electronic music producer, Alan Walker, has accumulated over 15 billion audio and video streams of his songs in the last few years. 15 billion. To put that into perspective, that's like having every last person on Earth listen to one of his tracks. Twice. And as I speak, his 2015 breakthrough hit, Faded, has nearly 3 billion views on YouTube alone, placing it inside the top 20 most popular videos of all time. Alan's success, though, is about more than just numbers. It's about having an ear for melodies and beats, which will work both on record and when blasted through enormous speakers to jumping crowds at venues around the world. On one tour, many months before the world had even heard of COVID-19, Alan came to play in London, and that's when today's presenter, John Wilson, caught up with him to learn about his beginnings, musical outlook, and how he approaches his craft. So, fire up the sound system, because this is In the Studio with Alan Walker.
When I start this song, it's mainly the melody. For example, I could do like a very standard chord progression. It could be like very simple, but then I try to kind of like change the melody to something new, something that sounds different. Yeah, it should be better, 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 better. In the studio, in the studio, in the studio, in the studio, in the studio.
Hello, I'm John Wilson, and in this edition, I'll be talking to the young Norwegian DJ and music producer, Alan Walker. Five years ago, at the age of just 17, Alan Walker became an international dance music sensation when a track called Faded, his debut as a professional recording artist, became a hit all around the world. The music video for the track has gone on to become one of the top 10 most liked videos on YouTube. Since that breakthrough, Alan has built a reputation not only as a producer in the studio, but as a live act in clubs, arenas, and festivals. And he's only just turned 23. I spoke to him in London as he was preparing for a DJ set many months before anyone had ever heard of COVID-19 and before the entire global live music scene was shut down overnight in response to the pandemic. At the time, Alan had an unusual look on stage, always appearing with a face mask covering his nose and mouth. When we met, neither of us, of course, had any idea that his look would become the norm, not for reasons of style, but health. Alan Walker's accent is Norwegian. He's lived in Bergen since childhood, and yet his name suggests other roots.
Well, my father is from Northampton, which I am as well.
Born in Northampton.
Yeah, and my mom, she's from Norway, and they met each other actually in Northampton. I don't know, they met at the school. When I was 2 years old, they moved from Northampton with me and my sister, and moved to Bergen, Norway.
So you have no memories of Northampton?
Absolutely none. I remember nothing, but I've seen photos and I've seen where I grew up, but I can't remember anything.
You've got such an English name, but you don't feel British.
I feel British, but at the same time, I feel very Norwegian as well. But I think that's also because I've grown up in Norway. Like, Norway is basically been my entire life. That's what I've grown up with, my mother's tongue, and also as a culture.
Alan Walker is usually referred to as an EDM artist. That's electronic dance music, the catch-all phrase that covers everything from house, techno and dubstep through to electro pop. So is there a big EDM scene in Norway?
Well, the past years, yes, it's much bigger now than it was before. Like, Norway has usually been known for like the black metal and different type
black
of music.
Black metal, that's... Yeah. Heavy metal, but with a real kind of macabre twist to it.
Yeah, basically heavy metal. And I think music has been shifting a lot lately. It's been more gone more from rock and stuff over to more EDM. And I think that's also become welcome because of the influence from Spotify, for example. Well, EDM is electronic dance music, and it's not one genre. It's basically the mother of all genres, and like you can listen to, like for example, techno, house, hands up, hardstyle, and you can still call it EDM. Like if there's anyone denying you from saying that that's not EDM, like then how can it not be EDM? Because EDM is basically any music.
You're happy to be described as an EDM artist?
Yeah.
You started out as a kid with a laptop, making music, watching other DJs on YouTube. Are you working in the same way in terms of the technology? Is it still very much just on a computer?
It's still just on a computer, but sometimes I like to kind of like implement with real instruments because I feel like nothing sounds more beautiful than a real instrument. And I must say, from the day when I was a kid to now, I love the piano.
Did you play the piano as a kid?
Not much, not at all. But my mom tried to get me into playing the piano, but I didn't find any interest in it. But as I started producing music at an older age, I found more interest in the music side, and therefore I felt like as I'm producing music, I feel like it's more correct that I'm also able to play the instrument.
Did you have lessons as a kid?
No.
So you just refused to have them? But
I refused to have them, but now like I'm pretty much self-taught through YouTube.
What was the key music that you were listening to growing up that led you to the sort of music that you're making now?
Well, it was more like techno, like really high BPM stuff, Hands Up, and pretty much hard style songs.
In Norway, in Bergen, where you grew up?
Yeah. From heaven straight to
hell. Norwegian DJs, or will you listen to music from around the world?
I just, like, I went on YouTube, searched for DJ A, and went through the list, DJ B, went through the list, and then that's pretty much how I ended up on DJ Ness at the same time, because I was kind of like just tired of listening to the mainstream music because I felt like there was so much things that was kind of like almost sounding the same. Then I discovered that producer and I felt like his stuff was so unique.
And what's his name?
DJ Ness.
Ness. And so he was an influence on you. What point did you think, I could do this, I could make a living from doing this?
That I could make a living off it, that's... I think that was maybe after... a while after Faded, because I was still in school and I was studying and final exams was coming up. You were the shadow to my light. Did you feel us? Another star, you fade away. Afraid our aim is out of sight. Wanna see you.
The single Faded was reworked from an earlier piece called Fade, which was made by Alan in his teenage bedroom. Faded turned him into a global musical sensation. To date, it's had 2.8 billion views on YouTube, which makes it one of the most viewed pop videos of all time.
When Faded got out, was released, I was kind of in school, but I was traveling so much between Bergen, Oslo, and Bergen and Stockholm because Sony, I sent to Sony Sweden, and at the same time as I was kind of like pendling between those places, it was really difficult to keep up with school. So music was going up and then school was going down. I've been producing electronic dance music now for since 2011, 2012.
So how old were you when you started?
I believe I was like 12, 13.
Can you remember the moment that you wrote Faded, or the first moment of inspiration, or how it started?
Faded, that was mainly like an idea that my manager had. Like the first time we met was at a breakfast at a hotel in Bergen. Like we had agreed on meeting. And then he proposed me the idea of doing a management deal and also doing something with my song.
Why was he interested in working with you at that point?
Well, he had heard my music. Like there was actually, like he found my poster. Well, not my poster, but like a festival poster in Bergen in the middle of nowhere. And then he saw the name Alan Walker on it. And he was like, what? That's not a Norwegian name. So he knew the guy that was hosting that event. And he called him, got my number, and he called me. And I was like, whoa, how did you get my number? Because I knew him, but he's a judge on Idol in Norway.
Oh, I see. So he's well known.
Yeah.
So when you first started making music, it was for yourself. But you became known because of gaming and online videos.
Yeah.
How did you make your name?
Well, I uploaded my music to the only platforms that I knew how I could get on, and that was SoundCloud and YouTube. Like, I had no idea how to get my music on Spotify and iTunes, for example. It was very interesting because I only uploaded it to my very small community. I got made friends on Facebook, for example, from all around the world that helped me promote my music and also develop as an artist. And I pretty much started off with nothing. Started off at YouTube with a few hundred subscribers, and I remember like just posting my songs, giving them away, and telling people that they could use them for free to anything that would like. And I think that also kind of like established my name in the industry, because there wasn't really many people that was kind of like giving their music away for free, like here, like just basically saying, here, just take this song, use it for whatever you would like.
So you were thinking it would be good for promotion to get your name out there then?
At that time, no. I just wanted to give my music. I couldn't take money for it. I didn't know how to make money from it. And money wasn't important for me at all. And I would say it still really isn't.
That's really fascinating, because so many artists over the years have said, you know, we need to be paid for our work, and especially when streaming and downloads, digital distribution of music first started, a lot of people were saying the artists are not getting the money they deserve. But you weren't bothered about that?
No, not at all. And like now, so you also have the Article 13, where there's a lot of speculations regarding like the copyright and everything. I think, as a music producer, I think like that rule or that change is only going to have a very negative effect on YouTube, for example, which was the place where I started off.
It may have been a kind of naive marketing strategy when you started off to give your music away for free, but if we now look at the videos that you've made that are posted on YouTube, the official videos, the number of hits, the number of views is quite astonishing.
It's, I don't know, it's mind-blowing. It's sound like, I think I'm crazy when I'm saying it myself. Like, it's kind of like living in a dream.
And I presume you're now making a living from the music. You're seeing some of that revenue coming back.
Yes, I do.
Have you changed the way that you write music and record music over the years?
Not really. Like, I haven't really changed a lot. But it also depends on if I'm working with a vocalist in the studio or if I'm starting from very scratch, like with no vocal or anything in mind in the studio.
Up until I don't know, 10, 20 years ago, a musician would have to wait until the studio booking before they could go and make the music, and would have to live with a song in their head or record it on a tape recorder, maybe. Mm. You can make music whenever and wherever you are in the world with your laptop. Mm. Does that mean you can never switch off?
It means that you can never switch off. And I feel like it's really good because now, like, you also have mobile applications where you can just, like, if you have an idea on the go, you can just easily just put it in your piano roll and save it, and then when you come home, you can put it in, well, make it into a bigger piece.
Does that happen? I mean, while you're, I don't know, here in London at the moment on tour, do you sometimes hear a melody in your head, you have to rush back to the hotel room, open the laptop and start work?
Sometimes, yeah. That's a very good feeling, because that's the first hint of a inspiration or like an idea that could eventually be really good. From the very start of the song, I would like to kind of like keep it very simple and have the first drop, have a breakdown, like some tension build up, and then I introduce a brand new melody again, which kind of like is a variation, because I feel like in some songs it could be kind of tiring to kind of like just listen to the same over and over again.
And explain the drop, that's really important for dance music, isn't it?
Yeah, the drop is basically, it's kind of like as you're reading a book, it has its storyline, it's building up, and then you come to kind of like the high point, I don't know, the climax in the song or in the book. It lasts for a while and then it goes down. And then it's kind of like you can start over again at the very start again of the book. And then it's kind of like doing the same again. So it's kind of like the same story, the same way it's written over and over again.
You're listening to In the Studio from the BBC World Service with me, John Wilson, talking to the Norwegian music producer and DJ, Alan Walker.
How much time is spent in the studio? Just give us a sense of how, from the starting point of hearing a melody through to releasing a track, how long do you think you'd spend on each track?
Oh, we can use Diamond Heart as an example here.
Hello, sweet grief, I know you will be the death of me. Feel like the morning after ecstasy, I am drowning in an endless sea.
Diamond Heart, first played live at the Belgian festival Tomorrowland in 2017 and released as a single the following year, has been another huge success for Alan Walker, with nearly 2 billion views on YouTube so far.
Thinking of that, the song was first premiered or basically dropped at Tomorrowland. In that time, I've completely changed the song, and I would say that song has gone so much back and forward, like I've been playing ping pong.
Do you ever take music to a live gig and then change it when you go back to the studio because you've seen a reaction? So are you almost sort of focus grouping, testing out the music on the audience?
Yes, sometimes I am. I change the vocal, the top line, like the lyrics and everything. And when we change the lyrics, the top line, I also change the production, because the new lyrics or the new top line didn't really fit with the old production. It's kind of like hundreds of hours just of sitting in the studio just trying to figure out what to do with a song in order to kind of like take it in the right direction, and then you get like your manager in and other people in, and they're like, no, you shouldn't do that, you should do this, and everybody has like their own opinion, but at the end of the day, I'm really happy with the outcome, and I feel like we all ended up on the same page when it comes to that song. So basically, hundreds of hours are being spent in the studio in order to kind of like finalize the song.
Never break the pattern, diamonds are shattered, beautiful and battered into
But because you're using beats and loops and samples and the plugins, those pre-recorded sounds that you can use, is it like you're building music rather than creating music?
Well, like for example, a few years ago, I was really interested in programming. I would say programming and making music is almost the same. Like you gotta program the sound as you're kind of like writing the code on a web page. And if you write something wrong in a code, it won't work.
And how do you know when it works? Is it just instinct?
It's just instinct. Like you're like, oh, this actually sounds really good. It's kind of like you're programming your own song. The bass, the hats, the snares, the drums and everything, the leads. And then at the end of the day, you have a fully put together song.
What prompts you to start a new track? Do you have to hear something in your head before you get to the studio, or do you go to the studio and then start improvising?
That is also very dependent. Often I hear something and have this idea. And sometimes I actually have that idea maybe days before, and then I have that urge to kind of get to the studio as soon as possible so I can get the idea that I have onto a computer where I can actually start working on it. But often I just do a voice memo, record ideas or melody ideas that I have, and then listen to them and try to kind of recreate the melody of that voice memo. And yeah.
You're a big gamer, aren't you? You spend a lot of time, when you're not making music, playing games. Would you like to create more soundtracks to those games? I mean, that has become a really big part of the gaming industry, hasn't it? Commissioning composers, musicians, creating soundtracks for these virtual worlds.
Yeah, not only for games, but I'm a very big fan of movie soundtracks. One of my major, biggest inspirations when it comes to not only movie soundtracks, but mainly producing music, is the movie soundtrack composer, Hans Zimmer. I've been listening to his music for a few years now, and I love his melodies. They're so simple, and I believe in music that's simple because it's what that just sticks to you, and it doesn't have to be complex to be good. And his melodies are so good, and they're so kind of like strong and powerful, and his compositions are perfect, and they're so, I don't know, like everything that goes along with perfection.
Which of his compositions particularly inspired?
My favorite piece by him is Time from the Inception movie.
And now he's had a chance to work with his hero, albeit remotely. This is a new Alan Walker remix of his favourite Hans Zimmer track, Time. And of course, there's a lavish video to go with it, created during the COVID lockdown, in which Zimmer is seen playing his piano at home whilst Alan and a team of assistants, all wearing masks, turn Time into an EDM banger. So far, just 8 million YouTube hits, but it's early days yet. The sci-fi looking video collaboration between Alan Walker and Hans Zimmer is actually quite poignant. It features images of people looking out onto deserted streets in cities around the world. And it's a reminder that Alan, who spoke to me before the soundcheck for a show in London many months ago, is just one of millions of musicians whose work on the live stage was cancelled due to the COVID crisis. He's a producer who works primarily alone in the studio, but his music is shaped by the euphoria of the communal experience in which thousands of people dance to the beats and melodies that first emerge from his laptop.
Well, live is also very important, and it's another way kind of like to, I would say, to export your music. And it's also, I would say, really important for people to kind of like get to know you, get to see you.
How does the music work in a live situation? Because obviously it's all created within your laptop. You could stand on the stage and hit play and stand back and let people enjoy it, but it's reinterpreted.
Well, when you're a DJ, you can like, you basically, you're a DJ, so you can like, how should I explain it? You pre-plan pretty much some shows, and sometimes you take everything on the go, and the whole thing is kind of like to mix everything together. You can put another song, you can put a vocal over another song, so you kind of like try to mix things over each other in order to make a mashup.
That sense of euphoria when the music is really working, and people lose themselves in the music, that must be an amazing thing for you to see.
It's really amazing to see, especially when it's your own songs. Like when you know, like you've been sitting there for hours in a studio, just working and working, and then you come out on stage, play the song, and you see people jump, you see them sing along, you see the joy, you see the love and passion that the crowd has.
Do you ever join in? Are you there in the crowd, or do you have to maintain your composure?
Well, I'm always up on stage. I'm never stage dived, if that's what you're trying to suggest.
What is your ambition for your music now, Alan?
Well, my main ambition to music is basically to make what I feel like that I can write from my heart and my feelings. I always like to put emotion into melodies.
Your life has changed radically in the last few years then, I guess.
It has completely changed. I still can't believe what I'm really doing.
Do you enjoy it?
I will say like I love what I'm doing. Just seeing the joy and happiness from playing for a crowd at the festival or at the club, or even my own headliner show, and just being able to kind of like live with my passion and taking what started as a hobby and make it become work has been mind-blowing, and it's been a dream come true.
The rave-ready Alan Walker. Fingers crossed he'll be back soundtracking people's summers at festivals around the world before too long. At least he's had a chance to catch up on some sleep this year. A big thanks goes to John Wilson, who presented and produced this week's story.